The Hawker Hurricane, mainstay of RAF Fighter Command in the Battle of Britain. In the fateful summer of 1940, two-thirds of Britain's monoplane fighters were Hurricanes. It was this unglamorous workhorse which bore the brunt of the fight against Hitler's aerial armada. During the battle, over 1,700 Hurricanes served with RAF Fighter Command, and Hurricanes accounted for two-thirds of all enemy aircraft shot down. Achievements of the RAF's Hurricanes have long since been overshadowed by the legendary status of the powerful and elegant Spitfire. The Spitfire's all-metal structure made it a revolutionary aircraft, and its performance far outclassed the Hurricane. Yet, it was the Hurricane's rugged and old-fashioned simplicity which was its greatest asset. It could be produced quickly and cheaply in large numbers using well-tried techniques. And numbers were of the utmost importance. In 1940, the RAF was facing the largest and most formidable air force in the world. If the bomber fleets of the Luftwaffe had been met only by small numbers of Spitfires, the RAF and Britain herself would have been quickly overwhelmed. Instead, the outcome was a victory which changed the course of the Second World War. The Supermarine Spitfire. The ultimate symbol of defiance and victory in the Battle of Britain. Fast, maneuverable, and strikingly elegant, the Spitfire was the cutting edge of RAF Fighter Command in its epic struggle against Hitler's Luftwaffe. More than 23,000 Spitfires were built, and the aircraft was the only Allied fighter to remain in production throughout the war. So sound was the design of this extraordinary aircraft that development would continue through an astonishing 24 Mark numbers, almost all of which went into actual production. Very few Spitfire variants were failures, something unique in the annals of fighter development. And so closely interwoven were the Supermarine and Rolls-Royce design programs that throughout the aircraft's history, only two engine types were fitted, the Rolls-Royce Merlin and Griffon. The diversity of the roles the Spitfire fulfilled during the course of the Second World War went far beyond all expectations. From fast interceptor to high and low level reconnaissance and tactical fighter bomber, the Spitfire again and again testified to the excellence of the original concept. Yet, when it was first conceived, the Spitfire was a project fraught with risk.
When the Focke-Wulf 190 made its maiden flight in June 1939, it was undoubtedly the most advanced combat aeroplane in the world. Heavy firepower and a staggering level of performance gave this small radial-engined machine the potential to outclass every contemporary Allied fighter. When it entered service in 1941, it was immediately successful, inflicting such heavy losses on its opponents that it soon became known as the Butcher Bird. During a career that lasted for 4 years, the FW-190 served in every German theater of war from North Africa to Russia. It became the Luftwaffe's second most numerous frontline aircraft and one of the most successful fighters of the era. It proved to be so versatile that it could perform equally well in a variety of roles, and by the end of the war, nearly 20,000 examples had been built. In addition to numerous fighter and fighter bomber variants, other versions appeared as ground attack aircraft, torpedo fighters, night fighters, trainers, and reconnaissance machines. By 1945, the Focke-Wulf 190 had earned the respect of German and Allied airmen alike. Many considered it to be the finest piston-engine aircraft to enter service with the Luftwaffe. And unlike the Bf 109, which had long since exceeded its development potential, Kurt Tank's masterpiece remained a formidable opponent for all but the best of Allied fighters. The Focke-Wulf Aircraft Company officially came into being in January 1924, when aviation pioneers Heinrich Focke and George Wulf teamed up with a well-known Bremen businessman, Werner Neumann. Wulf had joined the German Flying Corps nearly 10 years earlier, and by the end of the First World War, he was an experienced pilot. With Focke as the company's technical director and Neumann as its commercial director, Wulf was made responsible for all aspects of flying and testing. The company directed its earliest efforts to the production of light transport aircraft, but for the rest of the decade, there were no major successes. In September 1931, Focke-Wulf merged with the old Albatross company and gained the expertise of its most skillful engineers. November of the same year saw the arrival at the Bremen plant of the highly talented Kurt Tank. Trained as an electrical engineer, but with more than 20 years' experience in aeronautics, Tank was appointed as the new chief of design. Meanwhile, Heinrich Focke had become deeply interested in the development of helicopters. In 1932, he resigned from the board of directors and left to start his own company, Focke Achelis. Hitler's rise to power in 1933 heralded a complete transformation of Germany's aviation industry. Kurt Tank became a driving force, and with a first-class design team already in place, Focke-Wulf were awarded a string of development orders by the new German Air Ministry, the RLM. The FW-44 Stieglitz was the first to be ordered in quantity and gave the company worldwide recognition. As a two-seat biplane trainer, it was used by the Luftwaffe for more than a decade. Next in line was an advanced trainer, the FW-56 Stossa. This machine provided the inspiration for the Stuka and was the first Focke-Wulf to be fully designed and developed under the leadership of Kurt Tank. It was followed by the FW-57, the company's first all-metal aeroplane, and one of three main contenders in the RLM's 1936 Zerstörer competition. The same year saw the climax of a similar competition, with Arado, Heinkel, Focke-Wulf, and Bayerisch Flugzeugwerke all vying for the Luftwaffe's standard single-seat fighter contract. Heinkel, BFW, and Arado had all opted for low-wing monoplanes, but Kurt Tank's FW-159 used a high-wing layout with a retractable undercarriage. Plagued by unending problems with the undercarriage, it failed to win, and although the contract was awarded to Messerschmitt's Bf 109, Tank and his team had gained invaluable experience. Within 3 years, Tank had produced two remarkable aeroplanes. After outstandingly successful flight trials, the FW-190, or OWL as it was known, was grudgingly bought in quantity as a standard reconnaissance aircraft. Though it flew in numbers before the war, it was unknown to the Allies until it was disclosed in 1941 as the flying eye of the German armies. On the Eastern Front, it performed beyond all expectations. It retained its superb handling, which made it far from a sitting duck to fighters, and it showed great toughness of structure, more than once returning to base with one tail shot off or removed by a Soviet ramming attack. Planned solely as long-range commercial transport for Deutsche Lufthansa, the FW-200 Condor set up impressive record flights to New York and Tokyo, which resulted in several export orders. As a military aircraft, the FW-200 carried out long-range reconnaissance work and was also used to shadow shipping, acting as an airborne command post for U-boats, though the weak structure of the aircraft did little to endear it to its crews. By the end of 1937, the Bf 109 was in full-scale production, and much of its success was due to its Daimler-Benz 600 series engine. It was a brilliant piece of engineering. It had an inline configuration of 12 cylinders laid out in two rows. This followed the current attitude that a long, narrow engine offered a more streamlined shape, which in turn would allow the plane to go faster. The 600 series engine was also used in the Messerschmitt twin engine fighter, the Bf 110. The low drag offered by the streamlined shape was essential, and as always in the design of fighters, the constant quest was for speed. In 1937, the inline engine was in almost universal use in the fighter aircraft. British Hurricanes used the Rolls-Royce Merlin, which worked on the same principle, of a powerful engine in a streamlined shape. This is the Vought 141, an American pre-war plane that was never adopted. But one was sold to Japan, which led to assertions that the Empire used it as the basis for its fighter designs. Rather than use the inline engine, the 141 employed an air-cooled radial concept with the cylinders arranged in a circle around the crankshaft. Less aerodynamic than the inline, radial engines were nevertheless popular with the American Navy because they were more reliable and didn't require the added complication of a radiator. They were also much shorter, and so more planes could be fitted on the deck of an aircraft carrier. The Pratt and Whitney Company continued to develop the radial engine as an alternative to the streamlined air-cooled type. But apart from Navy fighters, their main use was for commercial and bomber aircraft, where an aerodynamic engine design wasn't quite so essential. In the early 1930s, some of Pratt & Whitney's radial engines were sold to Germany and were later manufactured under license by the BMW company. Despite the success of the 109, there were still people within the Luftwaffe who insisted on the need for a second fighter. Daimler-Benz simply couldn't produce more engines. And for this reason, the Focke-Wulf design was accepted as a backup because it utilized the BMW radial engine, which was less in demand. Kurt Tank's new design was sleek and streamlined, strong and yet simply built. The FW-190 was a design masterpiece. By early 1939, the jigs and tools necessary to build the 190 were put in place. From the outset, the intention was not only to have an aircraft for mass production, but to have production spread amongst a number of subcontractors, each one turning out large numbers of specific parts. Even in 1939, long before Germany suffered the first bomber raids, the German High Command could see the merits of mass production through a decentralized supplier system. These smaller factories would prove elusive targets to the Allied bombers. Before the war's end, the FW-190 was sourced from as many as 24 different points of manufacture. The model was no lightweight. Fully fueled, it would weigh nearly 10,000 pounds as against 8,000 for the 109. But the extra weight made for a stronger plane. This was a great advantage, which would allow the plane to endure the worst conditions. But the big question still remained. Would the added power of the BMW 193 18-cylinder engine be enough to make up for the extra weight and drag of the 190 design as against the Bf 109? Given that all the inline engines available for fighter production had been already committed to the Messerschmitt company, Kurt Tank had no choice but to design his way around the unpopular radial technology. Another difference from the 109 was that whereas it had demountable wings joined to the fuselage by a single spar, the FW-190 used very strong wings which were bolted together as one piece before the fuselage was positioned above. Even the joints were hidden behind an aerodynamic plate to aid strength and speed. Everything reflected the philosophy of Kurt Tank, keeping design simple, making components strong, and maximizing the technology currently available. Soon, the BMW engine was ready for fitting. This key component for the whole project was about to be tested in combination with the new formula of power, weight, and aerodynamics. On the 1st of June 1939, with the Focke-Wulf test pilot Hans Sanders at the controls, the first 190, known as the V1, taxied down the Bremen airfield to put these new theories to the test. Flying characteristics proved to be extremely impressive, with good stability, outstanding rock and dive rates, and light, responsive handling. But it was not all positive news. When he landed the aeroplane, Focke-Wulf's chief test pilot reported severe overheating problems with the BMW 139 engine. Subsequent flights confirmed his findings. Engine reliability suffered dramatically, and the temperature inside the cockpit rose as high as 45 degrees centigrade. In an effort to resolve the situation, the V1's streamlined propeller spinner was replaced by a close-fitting engine cowling. This alteration helped, but overheating was a fundamental problem, and one which was to plague the development program for the next 2 years. After completion of the first two prototypes, progress was made at a much slower rate. With the Messerschmitt 109 already well established, the German Air Ministry treated the Focke-Wulf with little sense of urgency. Modifications and testing continued throughout the whole of 1940. The third prototype was fitted with the more powerful BMW 801 engine, while other machines were flown with both large and small versions of the twin spar wing. Engine problems persisted, but by the end of the year, the Focke-Wulf had become a top priority. If it was to go into mass production, a decision had to be made. Before committing itself, the Air Ministry ordered a series of comparison trials to be carried out during 1941. In March, a team of experienced personnel from JG-26, supported by a group of engineers from Focke-Wulf, began exhaustive testing at an airfield near Rechlin. During the next few months, they completed an entire evaluation program involving the FW-190A pre-production aircraft and the Bf-109F. By the end of November, JG-26, under the command of Adolf Gallant, had tested the 190s under operational conditions. In the very first sortie over the Dunkirk area, they clashed with a stronger formation of Spitfires. And even though they were heavily outnumbered, the 190s still managed to shoot down three of the British machines. On the 10th of December, the Rechling assessment team issued its report. At ground level, the Focke-Wulf proved to be the faster machine, and at heights of 4 to 5,000 meters, it was almost as fast as the Messerschmitt. At high altitudes, its performance fell off sharply, and the Messerschmitt became the faster of the two by some 20 kilometers per hour. In a dive from any altitude, the 190 could outrun the 109 with ease, but in a climb situation, it was markedly inferior. It took almost a minute longer to reach 5,000 meters and over 6 minutes longer to reach twice that height. Even so, it had considerably more operational range, and in terms of maneuverability, it completely outclassed the 109. With light positive flying controls making it much easier to handle, the Focke-Wulf could outturn and outroll the Messerschmitt at any speed.
I liked that 190 very much. It was a much better airplane than the 109. You could curve it, you could fly fast, high, you could practically do everything with that aircraft. It was wonderful. So only a handicap, what had happened with the 190, when you take that plane out to your takeoff, you couldn't see very much. So that very large radial engine took away your vision. But you get used to it, so you be more careful. But flying that plane, it was a lot of fun.
In spite of its greater weight, good all-round visibility and a wide, robust undercarriage made it extremely safe for both takeoff and landing. This was in sharp contrast to the 109, whose unstable, narrow, tracked undercarriage made it notoriously difficult to land. Setting the Messerschmitt down on a soft or bumpy surface proved to be an extremely dangerous exercise, and many trainee pilots were killed while attempting to make their very first landing. Careful design and planning made the 190 an easy aircraft to maintain in the field. And an efficient method of construction, using separately built sections, ensured that it was both quick and simple to produce. It was immensely strong, and even in an emergency belly landing, the airframe usually suffered little or no major damage. Armor protection was provided for both the pilot and the engine. And with a basic weapons load of 6 machine guns, the Focke-Wulf easily outgunned the Messerschmitt.
I named the 109 a Floret, and the 190 a Sabre. The 190 was a rocket aircraft, but the 190 had a very good setup of weapons. They had 4 weapons around the engine, very close to the engine. And you can find that the serious kills in a day, up to 13, 14, like Novotny had, were done with a 190.
In their final analysis, the test team reported that in spite of its unreliable engine, the FW-190 was far less vulnerable in combat and had several significant advantages over the Bf-109F.
The Focke-Wulf had a very strong engine and in itself was very robust and well built. It coped very well with being shot at, probably more so than the Me-109. The Focke-Wulf had an air-cooled engine, and the Me-109 had a liquid-cooled engine, which meant that if, for instance, some shrapnel damaged the cooling system, the Me-109 couldn't continue, whereas the Focke-Wulf, with its air-cooled system, could. The Focke-Wulf was faster at lower levels, for instance, up to 6,000 meters. But above that, the Me-109 was superior. Most of the air fights usually happened below 6,000 meters, which meant that the Focke-Wulf had the advantage. It was much more robust than the Me-109, but some of the shortcomings were, for instance, that when dive bombing, because of the air-cooled system, depending on the speed, it would open up and therefore affect the stability of the aeroplane in the air. Sometimes the aircraft would tilt to one side and you could find yourself in a helpless situation. You had no control over it and it would be very difficult to right again.
By the end of the year, the RLM had placed a large order for more than 400 machines. Other orders followed, and before long, demand had exceeded the capacity of the Focke-Wulf factories. Under Air Ministry instructions, Arado, Fisello, and AGO were all assigned to build the aircraft under license. The production rate was swiftly increased, and by the spring of 1942, it had reached the level of 250 machines a month. First deliveries went to JG-26, and within a few weeks, the wing had three 190 groups fully operational. Their appearance in the skies over the Channel Coast area came as a complete surprise to the RAF. The Focke-Wulf completely outclassed the Spitfire Mk 5, and after scoring several notable successes, it became known to its opponents as the Butcher Bird. In February 1942, the new fighter took part in its first large-scale operation of the war, Operation Cerberus. At 11 p.m. on the night of the 11th, the twin battlecruisers Scharnhorst and Gneisenauer broke out of the French harbor at Brest. Accompanied by the heavy cruiser Prince Eugen, the two capital ships were ordered to force a passage through the Straits of Dover. Once clear of British-controlled waters, they were to head for the safety of their own base at Wilhelmshaven. The route was divided into five separate sections, and continuous air cover was provided by the Luftwaffe. Under the command of Adolf Gallant, the Focke-Wulfs of JG-26 and the Messerschmitts of JG-2 covered the distance from Le Havre to the mouth of the Rhine. From Jever to Wilhelmshaven, the ships were escorted by the fighters of JG-1. Shortly after midday on the 12th of February, the German force was spotted by a patrolling British reconnaissance aircraft. For the next 24 hours, the big ships were subjected to coastal artillery fire, numerous attacks by the Royal Navy, and repeated bombing raids by both the Royal Air Force and the Fleet Air Arm. But the defenders drove off every attack. During one raid alone, JG-26 shot down six Swordfish torpedo bombers, but for the loss of only four of its own machines, the Luftwaffe had destroyed a total of 49 British aircraft. In April 1942, JG-2 became the Luftwaffe's second fully operational Focke-Wulf wing. For the next 4 months, this aircraft dominated the Western Front, and as British losses rose, the RAF became increasingly alarmed. Using fighter-bomber variants of the FW-190, JG-2 and JG-26, successful hit-and-run raids against targets in Britain were carried out. During the ill-fated Dieppe landings, the two wings claimed the destruction of nearly 100 British aircraft. The British response to the butcher bird was extremely rapid. By the end of the year, Rolls-Royce had produced a new two-stage supercharged and intercooled engine, the Merlin 61. When it was fitted to the long-nosed Spitfire Mk 9, it transformed the situation completely. Although similar in appearance to its Mk 5 predecessor, the Mk 9 became the definitive Spitfire. It was a vast improvement over the previous versions, and with its dramatic increase in performance, it was more than a match for either the 109F or the Focke-Wulf 190. Douglas Bader, a top British fighter pilot, describes the reaction of Johnny Johnson, the RAF's top-scoring ace, to his first encounter with the FW-190.
Johnny came back in his chaps and he said, we met a new German aeroplane which had a round engine and squarish wingtips. And it outmaneuvered and was better than the Spitfire V in every respect. What was it? And the Air Ministry Intelligence came back and said, we think it must have been some old Curtiss aeroplanes the Americans sold the French, which they're using. And so Johnny said, well, if they've got some old Curtiss aeroplanes as good as that, can we have some, please? Anyhow, they discovered, I mean, a few weeks later, there was, in fact, the Focke-Wulf 190. Now, what they did then, the British manufacturers, they engined up the Spitfire, and it was a Spitfire 9. And the Spitfire 9 reigned supreme for the rest of the war. It was better than the 190. It outclimbed it, outdid everything.
The Spitfire war wesentlich überlegen. Es kam immer wieder darauf an.
The Spitfire was superior, but it all depended on what sort of technical tricks the enemy came up with and therefore went one better.
Andere Maschine leistungsmäßig zu überrunden.
When the Spitfire Mk 5 was introduced, we were faster, and also we were able to fly very low so that the Spitfire couldn't catch us. But then new models of the Spitfire were introduced with newer and improved engines, for instance, Rolls-Royce Merlin. And so they went into the lead again, as they could fly faster and higher than us. We had to quickly develop something better, so we brought in a water methanol injection system to cool the engine down, and that was an improvement of 60, 70, 80 PS, and once again we were faster than the Spitfire.
Und so konnten wir plötzlich der Spitfire wieder wegsteigen.
Two months later, JG-51 became the first Luftwaffe unit to operate the Focke-Wulf 190 on the Eastern Front. JG-54 followed shortly afterwards. And by January 1943, all four groups had been re-equipped with the latest A4 variant. As soon as they went into action, the Focke-Wulfs began to inflict heavy losses on the less well-equipped units of the Russian Air Force. In just one 48-hour period at the end of February, JG-51 shot down 89 Soviet aircraft.
The Russians didn't have any experience. The pilots were not trained in tactics. They flew very obsolete equipment, maybe from the Spanish War. The main bulk of their fighter fleet was the J-16 Rata, with a nickname, and the J-153, a biplane. And so the outcome was, you know, they suffered tremendous losses.
At the Battle of Kursk in July, the Luftwaffe claimed the destruction of another 450. But in spite of these successes, the air war in the West was beginning to turn in the Allies' favor. After the Casablanca Conference in January 1943, the American daylight bombing campaign began to expand to massive proportions. Raids increased in both size and frequency. And as the four engine bombers drove deep into occupied Europe, the Luftwaffe was forced onto the defensive. Its resources were stretched to the limit, and in order to cope with the threat, many fighter units had to be withdrawn from other theaters of war. By now, at least 16 field conversion sets were available for the Focke-Wulf. They enabled it to carry a wide range of specialized armament or equipment. Known as the Rüstsatz, each set contained a different package, identified by its own individual R number. By 1943, the American daylight bombing campaign was increasing in intensity, and many 190 units were withdrawn from other theaters to cope with the threat to Germany.
The types of missions depended on the situation. If only a few fighter planes were approaching, we would fly with four aircraft. But if there were more than that, or whole groups, we would fly with 8 to 12 airplanes per mission.
The autumn of 1943 produced some of the Luftwaffe's most notable victories over the United States bomber force. On the 1st of August, 55 heavy bombers were shot down during a raid on oil installations at Ploesti. 2 weeks later, the Americans attacked the industrial centers of Regensburg and Schweinfurt. Both targets were well beyond the range of Allied fighters, and the unescorted bombers had to face the full fury of the Luftwaffe for 2 hours each way. Sixty B-17s were lost on the first raid on the 17th of August, and almost a month later, another 60 bombers failed to return from a second crippling raid. Pilots used a variety of weapons and tactics against the unending streams of American and British bombers. Some fighters were equipped to fire 21-centimeter rockets from beneath each wing, while others flew above the bombers and dropped 250-kilogram bombs in the large formations.
One was always trying to improve fighter airplanes. This was the same with the enemy. When the Boeing Flying Fortress came in, we had to find new weapons to fight against it. That's why we even tried using rockets by suspending them underneath the wings.
Da hat man unter anderem auch versucht, mit Raketen die feindlichen Flugzeuge zu bekämpfen, die unter den Tragflächen gehängt wurden.
To counter the RAF's nighttime bombing campaign, three 190 Geschwaders specialized in a tactic known as the Wildesau. This involved fighter pilots and searchlight crews cooperating together to illuminate and destroy individual bombers. In spite of the darkness, any aircraft silhouetted by a searchlight beam presented an easy target. Wildesau units began operating in the summer of 1943, and with the aid of the Naxos homing radar, they became highly successful. After winning control of the night skies, they extended their operations by carrying out bad weather daylight interception missions.
Ich war im Raum, teilweise im Raum Güterburg stationiert.
I was stationed for a while near Güterburg and was with the JG-300 4th Group. I was a so-called high flyer. We were moved around quite a lot in the West. When the Arnhem and Nijmegen affair happened, I took it very personally. Then I was shot down near Recklinghausen. I have to say that these missions were the most depressing experiences I have had in my entire life as a pilot. When you were flying a very heavily armored aircraft and you had to attack transport planes, i.e. gliders, etc., and you knew there were human beings in there, it was really the worst experience.
Auf Transporter, praktisch Segler, Lastensegler, schießen musste, wo man wusste, sie sitzen voll Menschen.
During 1943, the strength of the Luftwaffe reached its wartime peak. By the middle of the year, Germany had more than 6,000 aircraft in frontline service. Focke-Wulf production had risen accordingly, and by the autumn, nearly 5,000 machines had been built. Between 1942 and 1944, the total output for all types of military aircraft was expanding at the rate of 60% a year. Meanwhile, on the Eastern Front, Hitler had launched Operation Citadel, aimed at destroying the Russian forces deployed in the vital Kursk salient. This large-scale offensive became the single most decisive battle of the entire Eastern Front. 2,500 panzers were supported by 8 German fighter groups, equipped with both the FW-190 and the Bf-109.
What was a surprise to us, they managed to set up a new production lines beyond the reach of our bombers, which was, in most cases, beyond the Ural Mountains or in this area. And they ran up to tremendous production numbers. They came. Better aircraft, all this MiG, Yak, Lak type aircraft, very good. And better trained pilots. And later on, from N-42 onwards, they formed these elite units.
Between them, these units managed to destroy nearly 450 Soviet aircraft during 7 days of almost continuous fighting. But in spite of this success, the German advance was halted. Kursk had become the turning point, and for the rest of the war on the Eastern Front, Hitler's panzer armies would be permanently on the defensive. By 1944, Russia had re-equipped with much improved aircraft.
The EL-2 was a dangerous airplane, you know. It was very hard to shoot it down because it was heavily armored. Downwards and backwards. You had a gunner in the back, and you have to aim very accurately to get it, you know. And very easily, I know a lot of pilots who really got rid of the whole ammunition and were still flying.
The inability for the German fighters to stop the Soviet aircraft, like the Stormovik, certainly influenced the tank battles on the Eastern Front. In February 1944, the American bombers resumed their daylight campaign. But this time, they were escorted by long-range fighters. With German industry as its principal target, the 8th Air Force mounted repeated raids on the factories of Focke-Wulf, BMW, and Messerschmitt. The Luftwaffe's defenses were once again stretched to the limit. And in an effort to relieve the situation, Focke-Wulf formed its own Works fighter unit. A small group of test pilots flying FW-190s took part in operations to defend the Bremen plant. Kurt Tank himself flew on several of these missions, but the Air Ministry eventually became so worried about his safety that they banned him from doing so. As the raids continued, many new fighters were destroyed on the ground long before they could be delivered to their operational units. In desperation, the Luftwaffe formed another specialist group known as the Sturmstaffel or Rammerjäger. Each pilot who joined this unit was provided with a heavily armored Focke-Wulf 190. He was briefed in ramming techniques and was expected to bring down at least one Allied bomber on every interception mission. Meanwhile, other Focke-Wulfs were fitted with a variety of anti-bomber and anti-tank weapons. The SG-116 consisted of either 3 or 6 Mark 103 cannon mounted vertically on the upper fuselage. Known as the Zellendusche, this device was designed to shoot down bombers by firing directly into them from underneath. Using a photoelectric cell, the 30mm guns were automatically triggered by the shadow of a bomber as it passed overhead. With equipment that is more or less equal, quantity and aggressiveness would tip the balance, and the P-51s, P-47s, and the Spitfire Mk 9s in quantity turned the aerial tide in Europe. Top American fighter ace in World War II, Francis Gabreski, flew the Spitfire Mk 9, the P-51, and the P-47.
Spit 9 was designed principally as a fighter interceptor, and it was just a tremendous airplane in that particular role. However, it had its limitations. It didn't have the range. It didn't have the endurance. So as an escort airplane, all they could do is escort probably to the coast of France and back, and that's about all. And that's why we came in with the P-51 and the P-47, plus the P-38. I would say for long-range work, the P-51 is probably a better airplane because it had greater range than a P-47. P-47 had its limitations, and that's the part that the P-51 played in European theater. But we had 8 machine guns in the P-47, which was tremendous firepower compared to the 6 machine guns that you had in the P-51. And there was no other fighter in a world with that amount of firepower. It was a sturdy airplane, built like a tank, and I could drive it through most anything. It was more than a match for the Focke-Wulf 190. It was more than a match for a 109. We had water injection that was sustained power to keep us there for about 3 minutes, up to 5 minutes, depending upon how you use it. But it gave us that tremendous edge that we needed against the German Luftwaffe.
Throughout the war, the FW-190 excelled as a versatile weapons platform. It was the ideal aircraft for low-level and medium-altitude operations. But at heights of over 7,000 meters, its poor engine performance made it relatively ineffective. Focke-Wulf attempted to rectify the weakness by developing 2 new series, both equipped with more powerful engines. The B-series prototypes used a GM1 power booster, while the C-series machines were fitted with a turbo-supercharged Daimler-Benz engine. Both types incorporated a pressurized cockpit, but neither of them proved to be reliable enough to go into full-scale production. High-altitude performance remained an inherent problem until the D-series arrived in 1944. Kurt Tank solved the problem in a different way. The Junkers Ju-88 was a versatile bomber that used several different engines, amongst them the Jumo-213. It looked similar to the radial engine, but was in fact a V-12 inline engine with a circular radiator behind the propeller. Unlike the Daimler-Benz, the Jumo engine was in plentiful supply, and in a bold move, Tank arranged for this engine to be fitted to the 190. With this combination of a bomber engine fitted to a fighter, Focke-Wulf started to develop what might well have been the best fighter of World War II. In order to balance the aircraft, the rear fuselage was lengthened by 4.5 feet and a larger tail fin was fitted. When the prototype made its maiden voyage at Langenhagen in May 1944, it was an instant success. With a top speed of 685 kilometers per hour, it was faster than all other 190s at any height. It had a better rate of climb, greater acceleration, and a significantly higher service ceiling. In an emergency situation, the MW-50 water methanol injection system could boost power output by almost 30%. Overall, the new variant was a vast improvement over its predecessors. Before long, operational pilots were hailing the 190D as the best piston engine fighter ever to enter service with the Luftwaffe. But as the year progressed, the odds facing the German fighter units were overwhelming. On the 9th of April 1944, accurate American bombing raids destroyed 70% of the Focke-Wulf plant at Marienburg. 2 months later, when the Allies landed in France, they were supported by an available force of more than 4,000 fighters and fighter bombers. To oppose this immense aerial armada, Germany had less than 300 operational fighters stationed in Normandy. The fear of a second landing in the Pas de Calais kept the Luftwaffe's reinforcements out of the battle zone for another 2 weeks. And by the time they arrived, Berlin had ordered combat operations to be kept to a minimum due to the severe shortage of fuel. By June the 20th, 15 groups of Focke-Wulfs were available for action on the invasion front. In spite of difficulties, they managed to inflict heavy casualties on the Allies. But soon, every German airfield within striking distance of Normandy was under continuous attack. Within a few weeks, the Luftwaffe had lost nearly 1,000 aeroplanes. And as the Allies began their relentless advance, the surviving German fighter units were withdrawn to defend their homeland. In October, Hitler announced plans for one last desperate effort in the West. By making a surprise attack through the Ardennes forest, he intended to split the British and American armies and force a way through to the coast. As a prelude to the offensive, the Luftwaffe would shield the panzers by making a series of mass attacks against Allied airfields. Planning was meticulous, and on the 1st of January 1945, 800 fighters took off on Operation Bodenplatte. Led to their targets by Ju-88s, the FW-190s and Bf-109s struck at 17 airfields throughout Belgium, France and Holland. The heaviest casualties were inflicted by JG-26 at Aveyr, near Brussels. Taken completely by surprise, more than 100 Allied aircraft were destroyed on the ground. But elsewhere, the attackers were not so successful. At Asch Airfield in Belgium, 13 Focke-Wulfs and 10 Messerschmitts were destroyed by 12 Thunderbolts from the 487th Fighter Squadron. A group of Spitfires from 131 Wing shot down 20 more for the loss of only one. Overall, 93 German fighters were destroyed over Allied-held territory. On the return home, many more were shot down by their own anti-aircraft guns. By the end of the day, British and American losses amounted to 250 machines, but Germany had lost more than 300 pilots. It was a complete tactical failure. All of the Allied aircraft could be replaced within a few days, but the loss of both pilots and machines was a devastating blow for the Luftwaffe.
Ich kann Ihnen da eine Geschichte erzählen. Ich sollte damals, unser Kommandeur,
I can remember a story. Our commander's aircraft had a problem with its transmitter and he couldn't get it to work, so he jumped into my aircraft. I left about half an hour later to fly from Kamen to Cottbus to follow him. Just then, a large group of Mustangs appeared around me, about 12 of them. They all prepared to attack me, but because I was an experienced pilot, I managed to evade the whole group. They raced towards me. I used all my weapons that I had and shot at them like mad.
Die Mustangs sind an mir vorbeigezischt, nach unten weg.
The Mustang pilots got really annoyed and frustrated with me, because they couldn't get me. me against 12.
Und bin dann genau auf die zu und habe sämtliche Bordwaffen auf sie abgefeuert.
I realized that my time was running out and I decided to take a nosedive and head for the Russian border.
Das ist etwas auseinander und aus dem Konzept geraten, weil ich ja nun alleine war und sie waren ja in der Überzahl.
They followed me for a while, but they couldn't catch me.
Dass ich keine Chance mehr hatte. Und deshalb habe ich diese paar Sekunden, die
they left flying very low towards the east. But then they realized they had entered Russian airspace. So I was hoping that then they would turn back, which they did.
Und die Mustangs sind dann natürlich hinterhergekommen, aber die Piloten haben es nicht mehr fertig gemacht, mich einzuholen.
Once more I got away with it.
Ganz tief in nur in ganz wenigen Metern über die Erde in Richtung Osten, man plötzlich war die Front schon überflogen, unter uns waren die Russen und ich hatte gehofft, dass dann die Amerikaner mit ihren Mustangs abbiegen oder zurückfliegen. Das haben sie dann auch endlich getan. Und ich bin noch mal so mit heiler Haut davon gekommen.
One by one, the German generals surrendered their armies. The final capitulation took place on May the 7th, and with Göring himself a prisoner of the Allies, the resistance of the Luftwaffe finally came to an end. By March 1945, the Russians had overrun all of the Focke-Wulf factories in the east. The Western-based plants had all been badly damaged, and heavy Allied bombing raids had destroyed most of the airfields in Germany. By the beginning of April, there were less than 1,000 FW-190s left in service. When the final collapse came a few weeks later, they were systematically destroyed by the Allies, along with the rest of the German war material. All over occupied Germany, American Air Force intelligence teams moved quickly to collect examples of German technology before they were destroyed by retreating troops. In this way, Allied intelligence came across scores of FW-190s, providing many specimens to examine and compare. This rare footage shows one FW-190 that was captured and transported to America for further study.
An der Focke-Wulf hat mir erstmal gefallen, dass sie stark.
I liked it very much because it was strong, robust, well equipped and with varied weapons, easy on takeoff and landing and a real pleasure to fly.
In der Luft, also kinderleicht zu fliegen war und gut instrumentiert war dazu.
The instrument panel was very easy to read. All in all, a brilliant aircraft, no doubt about it.
Fliegerisch, also tadellose Maschine, da gibt's gar keinen Zweifel.
Yes, once I did have the opportunity to fly the Focke-Wulf in practice. I did 13 exercises with the Air Force for 5 flying hours. I was very impressed with the aircraft, and I enjoyed flying it so much that I later signed on a voluntary basis to go to the front with the Focke-Wulf group. Yes, I would like to answer this question with a definite yes. The Focke-Wulf was one of the best fighter aircraft of the Second World War.
The FW-190 was a plane that was ordered as an afterthought, a backup for the 109. It was allowed into production because it used unpopular radial engines. German engineers worked their way around its drawbacks and achieved a compromise where extra power overcame the problems of aerodynamics. The radial engine survived its critics and was adopted by the British, Japanese, and American fighter manufacturers. The FW-190 went on to become one of the world's great fighter aircraft.